Hello, my name is Mark Vorend. I'm a lecturer and researcher at the Hydraulic Engineering Department of Delft University of Technology. I will explain the basics of dike design. I will concentrate on the hydraulic engineering part. In reality, urban, spatial quality, ecological and urban aspects have also to be taken into account. The purpose of a dike is to reduce flood risks by protecting land from being covered by water. The higher the dike, the better it can resist higher water levels, and the lower the flood risk becomes. To determine how high the dike should be, the consequences of a flood are compared with investments needed to prevent it. A maximum acceptable flood probability comes out. Because there is a relation between flood probability and extreme water level, the design height of the dike can then be determined. The height of a dike is the basic design parameter. Other properties, like the geometry, the shape, and materials, have to be designed in such a way that the dike is sufficiently stable. So, we start with determining the crest height of a dike. It should be higher than the design water level. So, I start painting the foreland, actually the bed of the river or the sea, and then here is the slope, outer slope of the dike. Somewhere here is the water level. We indicate like this. This water level shows some variations, of course, because there is some tidal differences. So I have a minimum, which we call ebb, and we have a flood level. And even these astronomical tides show differences, because sometimes we have even larger floods, which we call spring flood, and we have the neap tide, depends on the position of the sun and the moon relative to the Earth. And we should, of course, design a dike in such a way that it resists the highest water level, and then it will resist the lowest water levels as well. So we could extend this line to the dike here. It can even be higher than this highest astronomical level, because during a storm there's a lot of wind blows over the water, and it pushes up the water level. Can be up to 1 or 2 or even 3 meters higher than the spring tide. So our dike has to resist that level as well. And we should also look ahead in time, because during the reference period, the lifetime period of a dike, we can expect some sea level rise, or even in the rivers, higher river discharges. So we have to add another, we could say 1.5 meter. For instance, it is not sure, we have some uncertainties about this sea level rise, because we don't know exactly how much it will be. So this is dependent on scenarios, but we have to take this into account determining the dike height at the end of the lifetime period. But even now we are not ready, because these are still water levels and we have a lot of waves on top of these still water levels, and the waves can overtop the dike, and we have to restrict the amount of water flowing over a dike, because it will lead to erosion of the inner slope. So the amount of water going over it will not immediately lead to flooding of the hinterland, but erosion of the inner slope is much worse, because it can undermine the stability of our dike, and then you have flood immediately. So it has to be restricted. And we can restrict the amount of water flowing over the dike by making it higher. So like this. And the height needed for that, so we call it the overtopping height or the freeboard, depends on the protection of the inner slope. And when it's really well protected, we can allow up to 200 liter per second per meter dike. If it's only grass or sand, it's up to 1 liter per second per meter, which we can allow. But that depends on the height of the crest of the dike. So this is actually our crest level of the dike. It consists of the still water level, extreme water level, plus some overtopping height for the waves. But when you add extra weight on the subsoil, I should say that's this level, we have extra weight because of the mass of all the soil in the dike body. you get some settlements of the soil below the dike, and it's kind of compaction of this soil. And when it goes down, also the crest height will go down. And so you have to compensate this already during construction. So you have to put extra height on top of the dike. So at the end of the lifetime, it will reach the design crest height. The height of a dike can be lower if the waves are dissipated. You can do it by constructing an outer berm, so in front of the dike here. So the waves that are coming in will break here. The wave energy will dissipate, so it will reduce the amount of water going over the dike. So this means that to reach the same allowable overtopping discharge, you can lower the crest height of a dike. So you can save this part, save costs, because you have less height, but you have, of course, extra cost by constructing the berm over here. So you have to balance also here the cost of reduction that you gain by lowering the dike by constructing the berm, including the refitment. And of course, you have a better view over the flood defense, of course, here. So it's extra value by lowering it, but it's difficult to quantify in a cost-benefit calculation. I think I should start with a new drawing now. I've drawn the outer berm, as you can see here, and it's applicable to sea dikes mainly because along the coast we have a lot of waves, can be really high waves, and the overtopping height can be up to 5 meters, so it could double the height of the crest of a sea dike. But along rivers we don't have that high waves, it can be up to half a meter. So we don't need the outer berm along rivers. But sometimes we even see berms on the inner slope of a dike, and it's mainly used for stability. After heavy rainfall or after a high water level, the soil becomes saturated here, and because of its weight, it starts sliding in a rotational way. So you could say this is the center of the rotational movement. These are the radians, and the berm counteracts this movement. So it's extra weight on that side of the slope, and it provides extra stability. Sometimes we need a piping berm. It's much lower and much longer. Also on the inner side of the dike. And that prevents seepage under a dike. So it makes the seepage length much longer. And seepage actually is a failure mechanism where water flows under a dike from one side to the other side. And actually the seepage is not a real problem, but when the small grains start extruding from these small tunnels, you could say, that could undermine a dike. And so you get failure and you have a breach, and then the polder will flood. So actually we have three kinds of berms in a dike. So on sea dikes we have a berm on the outer slope, and we can have a stability berm on the inner slope, or a much lower and longer piping berm also at the inner slope. Thank you for your attention.